And I am pleased to announce our final keynote speaker, Mr. Chris Hjelm, Executive Vice President and Chief Information Officer at the Kroger Company. Chris is responsible for managing the Kroger Company's nationwide network of information technology, including systems used in retail stores, manufacturing facilities, distribution centers, and offices. Chris joined Kroger in 2005 as Senior Vice President and CIO before being promoted to his current role in 2015. Before joining Kroger in 2005, Chris was CIO of Cindance Travel Distribution Services. He also served as Senior Vice President of Technology at eBay Incorporated, Executive Vice President at Excite at Home, and Senior Vice President and CIO at Federal Express Corp. Chris earned a bachelor's degree from Colorado State University and an honorary PhD from Colorado Technical University. Chris and his wife, Karen, live in Cincinnati and have three children. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me in welcoming to stage Mr. Chris Hjelm.
All right, good morning. I feel a little unqualified to talk to an ag group. The one thing I did do, I worked on my uncle's dairy farm when I was a kid. So that was never a true vacation, because you know a dairy farm, you get put to work. And then we had a big garden when I was a kid, so I rototilled and I harvested things, but that's about as far as it goes. But we're going to talk a little bit today about customers, consumers, because I have to be careful using the word customer, because that can mean different things to different people. We're going to talk about consumers, and we're going to talk about food. How many of you like food? Hopefully all of you do. You need it. Hopefully you like it. But that's the business we're in. And we're going to talk a little bit about connecting, you know, what happens in the ag world with how we think about customers, consumers, and food. At Kroger, we start every meeting with an uplift story. So what I thought I'd do today is show you a picture. Anybody think where that might have been taken? Houston? Houston. The patient was in a diabetic coma. The helicopter obviously couldn't get to a hospital, so they found Kroger. And they were able to, the person that was actually working, the pharmacist, hadn't gone home that night because they were serving lots of customers. So they happened to be able to administer what this patient needed, got him out of their diabetic coma, and it's a success story. The reason I share that is because that's part of who we are. Right, we're in your communities. Here it's King Soopers. But this is an example of what we do every day, and our people are extraordinary. So what I want to show you is a quick video about Hurricane Harvey. We actually have quite a few folks that came from King Soopers and City Market down to help in Houston as well. So people from all across the country have really leaned in to help. They're going to have a long journey ahead of them. We had three stores that were not open. I think within 3 days of the hurricane departing, we had all but three stores open, which is just an amazing feat. There was one store I think that they talked about. They had 10 associates basically running a big store. The only thing they were doing was manning the check lanes and helping customers check out. You can imagine what it might have looked like on the shelves after a day or two, but it is what we do, and things are coming back quickly. I'm going to talk a little bit about Kroger. I think most of you know us, but I'm going to give you maybe a little bit of breadth that you might not understand. We're going to talk about food quality and safety. It's a big deal to us. It's a big deal to you. And then we're going to talk about personalization of food and where that's trending. And then last, I'm going to talk about future opportunities and where I think what we do for a living and what you all support and do for a living can come together. We feed the human spirit. That's what we strive to do. Every associate, every customer, every day, we try and create an uplifting experience when you come in our stores. We want you to come out feeling better when you leave than when you came in. We have 9 million customers a day that walk through our doors, which is a pretty large number of people. So if we can do this well, we not only make great experience for our customers, but we also create a place where our associates want to work. And so the ability to feed the human spirit through food and through engaging with customers and associates is something we strive to do every day. And as you can imagine, with 450,000 associates, it's not easy. With over 2,800 stores, it's the consistency of making this happen every day is something that we'll forever be aspiring to do. This is a map of who we are nationally. You can see there's a lot of Kroger in kind of the Midwest, South Central US. There's a couple on the right that are Harris Teeter's new in the last couple years. And then up in Chicago, you see Roundy's. And in Chicago, or in the Chicago area specifically, it's Mariano's. But this is who you know us as across the country. A little bit more about the numbers. You can see we're a fairly large retailer, $115 billion last year. I mentioned the 450,000 associates, it's slightly a larger number. Something as simple as digital coupons, how many of you engage with our digital coupon program? How many of you are loyal customers? Actually, let me ask that. Every hand should go up, I hope. I would expect nothing less of this group. The digital coupons is a program that was started in 2009. And today, we are downloading, we're close to 5 billion coupons that have been downloaded. Now, the pace of that's pretty interesting. In 2017, as of probably a couple weeks ago, we were at 1 billion coupons downloaded just year to date in 2017, which shows you how much more quickly people are moving to digital. Obviously, from a sustainability perspective, it's good news because it's going to be less paper that we're printing. 38 food production plants. It's kind of a little bit more close to the ag world. We do everything from peanut butter to dog food. The biggest thing we're in is probably the dairy business for us is probably our largest business. We have several dairies across the country. So when we think about food safety and the supply chain, we're pretty closely connected to the ag world. Tech, data, and innovation is kind of at the core, and I'll talk a little bit more about some specific innovation shortly. But we have a history of innovation in the company, and when I got there 12 years ago, we started shortly thereafter a research and development group. And you know, it's really been kind of the engine for innovation in the company over the last decade. We also have had a history of data science and analytics. So if you think about, Kroger was one of the first retailers to offer a loyalty card. That loyalty card offered an enormous amount of data. The question is, what do you do with it? And our 8451 business, which is over 500 professionals that are in basically data science and analytics, we know everything we can possibly know about our customers, all of you, and we use it to make sure we're offering you the right, you know, products in our stores. We're making sure that you get the right pricing. We make sure that you, you know, get the right meal suggestions that are based on what we know you like. So we're doing an enormous amount with data, and what you're going to see happen quickly is, you know, that data pool expands. It expands to social media. A lot of people talk about food and social media. Is that interesting to us? Of course it is. We want to know if they're talking about Kroger and how we can do a better job and things that they like that we can do more of. But we also want to know if they're eating out at a restaurant where they like a particular kind of Thai food. So we look at food trends. We try and look everywhere we can to get more insight about what's going on and how we can better serve customers. If you think about the trends that are going on in the industry, things we think a lot about, obviously online grocery ordering, we are now up to the number literally changes every week, but ClickList, which is order online, pick up in store, is in over 760 stores. I don't know how many of you have tried ClickList? Any raving fans out there for ClickList? Every week, all right. It changes people's lives. We have so many testimonials from customers that, you know, we've actually made, you know, grocery shopping easy. People that maybe can't leave their homes. We're doing some work with Uber in a couple markets where they're delivering groceries to people's homes. So we're trying to make sure that whatever way the customer wants to connect with us, that we make it as easy as possible. On the meal kits, there's an enormous amount of activity going on nationally and actually globally with meal kits. How many of you have ordered a meal kit online to your home? Yeah, whether it's Blue Apron or Yumly, Gobble, there's so many out there. And the point is that, you know, it's about simplicity. It's how you can make someone's life a little easier. Meal planning can be a chore. Many of us are time starved. So for many people, that's a big help. We'll talk a little bit more about kind of what Kroger's doing in that space in a minute, but it's definitely, you know, anything to do with convenience matters a lot. I talked a little bit about home delivery. Restaurants, you're gonna see more and more, I think, certainly in Kroger, restaurant-like experiences in our stores. Now, it won't be every store. It'll have to be the right socio-demographic, but you're gonna see more of that. Today, in quite a few stores, I don't know about here as much, but beer and wine tasting are pretty common now. Food court-like concepts where you can actually go in and order food from maybe the local barbecue place. We recently put, in Cincinnati, if you ever go there and you like barbecue, I would highly recommend Eli's Barbecue. Eli started with one store, and what we did was we created a relationship with Eli's where they're now inside one of our stores. That place has been open for a month. They're killing it. Because people don't want to go stand in line at Eli's at the restaurant, but they love the simplicity of coming to Kroger. And oh, by the way, they can get anything else that they need for the family. So we're starting to create these, you know, once again, save people time, create compelling experiences that get them to want to engage with us. Organic and natural. Simple Truth, I think if I remember the number right, last year was a $1.7 billion brand. You know, I think a few years ago people might have said, oh, well, natural and organic might be a bit of a fad. I think anybody that said that obviously is probably now a believer. And, you know, the amount of natural and organic in our world just continues to grow. Now, the good news is the economics continue to get better. You know, for a while, there was a pretty big difference in price, and, you know, some customers weren't able to afford it. But, you know, we continue to work to make natural and organic affordable for everyone. And I think we're seeing a lot of progress, and I believe continued growth in that sector. And that, lastly, this new store technology, and you've heard, you know, I think I read a lot, and I'm sure I'll get a question or two about what's going on in the retail market with technology. A few years ago, we introduced a technology called QVision, and it's a couple years old now, but fundamentally what we did was we counted shoppers coming in the store, and we used predictive analytics to figure out when they'd be checking out, and every store is different. I mean, it takes us 30 days to train the system because every store is that different. But then we can predict very accurately how long a customer is going to shop. And then we took wait times from over 4 minutes down to 30 seconds before you'd start the checkout process. You think about it, that's pretty transformational. Back to, you know, people want convenience, people don't like waiting in line. That was one of those things that we said, we've got to get checkout right. We're working on service department queuing. We're doing some tests right now with video analytics in pharmacy and delis, where it's a disaggregated queue, so it's a slightly harder problem to solve, but how long has somebody been waiting? And how do we help the associates know, hey, this person's been waiting for 60 seconds, this person's been waiting for 2 minutes, excuse me, whatever our standard is, how do we ensure that the team working in that department can take care of the customers? So there is an enormous amount of technology that's going into stores, and we believe that, you know, it is complete digitization of the store that's taking place. So these are a little bit about the trends. Sustainability and sourcing for us has been a part of our DNA, and we've done a lot specifically around working with the World Wildlife Foundation on 100% sustainable seafood, as an example. We've committed to, you know, 100% cage-free eggs. I can't remember the exact year, but it's early in the 2020s. Now, you can imagine we sell a lot of eggs, so if the supply were there, we could flip the switch tomorrow, but we have to work with the the producers to actually make sure that the supply is there so we can deliver on that commitment. We actually did put an anaerobic digester out in Southern California a couple years ago. I think it's a 55-ton system, but it basically powers the entire distribution center in Southern California. So this is a biofuel, you know, program that we put in place. So instead of, you know, that organic waste going into a landfill somewhere, we're actually creating fuel from it. So it's there's an enormous amount of, you know, activity going on to, you know, how can we be more sustainable? How can we make sure we don't have food waste? And specifically on the sourcing side, a lot more done locally. So when we think about carbon footprints, how do we take things locally and eliminate steps in the supply chain so we can get them straight to the store? I mean, sure, they can go to a distribution center and back out, but if they're already in that community and local, how do we connect with the farmers and the growers to actually go direct to store? There's a lot in this space that's exciting, and obviously it connects with many of our customers. I mean, they're concerned, we're all concerned about, you know, sustainability and the, you know, kind of the carbon footprint of Kroger and everyone else, and what's our role? How do we play a leading role in that? Now, food quality and safety, this don't try and read this, this is really hard, but what I wanted to show you was there's a history of innovation. So Kroger's been around since 1883. Which is not the oldest company, but certainly one of them. And if you look through, what you'll see is, and in fact, the picture in the upper right is a person, a scientist, checking the chew factor of jelly beans. I'm not sure too many food retailers would be doing that. Certainly not back then. We were the first large retailer to introduce scanning technology. So you think about the barcode world we live in today and scanners, Kroger was a pioneer in that technology. You can also see, as you move kind of into the red area, and if you go down on the pictures, there's a, you'll see the scanners in the third picture kind of in the middle, and then the next one down is a scanning tunnel. So we built a complete scanning system so people don't, you literally just load your items on a belt and everything gets scanned automatically. We actually had a little bit of trouble getting that system to look friendly. Some people thought it was irradiating their food or something. It wasn't, trust me, but it was just, I think we'll make another run at that technology, but it was something that we pioneered a while back. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about the shelf edge in a second, but in the lower right, what you see is actually an IP camera system. And that IP camera system also is a Zigbee router. Now, not to get too technical, but just real quick, I'll get to it in a second. So if you think about, back to food safety. So this is a US set of US statistics. 48 million people a year will get a foodborne illness. 128,000 will go to the hospital. 3,000 will die. So when you think about our collective role in the supply chain and food safety, it's a big deal. So what do we do, right? What can Kroger do? What do we do to manage the supply chain? This was the way we used to manage temperatures. And we have a lot of refrigerated and frozen cases in our stores, as you can probably imagine. Used to be that there would be a thermometer in the store, and you go to a lot of our competitors and you'll still see thermometers. What happens with a thermometer? Somebody's got to go check it. So what we did was we said, you know, we want to make sure that, you know, there's quality food. How many of you have ever bought ice cream and had a lot of ice crystals in it? Okay, what happened? It got too warm, it melted, and then it refroze. The other things that obviously happen are legitimate food safety issues. You know, it's back to the foodborne illness I mentioned. So we looked at this problem and we said, no, we've got to change it. So what we did was we designed, and you can see those black tags that are sitting in the in that case right there. That's a self-contained tag. It has a battery in it. The battery life's, you know, we haven't probably tested it fully, but we think it's in the 9 to 10 year range. And that Tag is basically speaking a network protocol called Zigbee. So think of it, if you've got Bluetooth, you're all familiar with Bluetooth, you've got Wi-Fi, Zigbee kind of sits in the middle on the wireless spectrum. Its properties are twofold. One is it has very granular locationing. So in essence, what that means is you get kind of GPS for all of these tags. So I know where all of them are in the store. You also have very low power consumption, so it's not a very chatty protocol. So that's why the battery life is so long. So what this is a picture of is this is what we see in the store. So what you see is all of those green dots are temperature tags, and you can then get an alert if something's not right, or if the defrost cycle, and the hardest part of this problem, by the way, was data. It was getting the specifications from the manufacturers of these refrigerated and frozen units so that we knew the defrost cycles and we wouldn't have false positives. So we spent a lot of time getting the data right, but in essence, what happens now is if it's a frozen case, we actually don't care that it's below the desired temperature because we want to keep things cold. However, we also know that that's not good for energy consumption. So we do want it to be at the right temperature. So we do this both for energy consumption reasons as well as food safety. But what we do is when we see an alert, the store manager will get an alert, as well as the facility engineer, so the person that would actually go repair one of these units. And we're able to quickly triangulate on the issue, we know where it's located, and we're able to get it resolved. When we put these systems in, one of the things that we find is that what we think is, you know, a well-maintained system isn't maybe as well-maintained as we thought. Now the beauty is, and we had a situation in a store a couple years ago that I shop at where the entire cheese case was empty. And I said, well, what happened? And they said, well, the compressor went out last night and we came in this morning and, you know, the temperature had been too high for too long and we had to basically throw away all the product. That doesn't happen anymore. And we are obviously making sure that the food is at the right temperature all the time. And I'm not sure in a manual system how you could do that. I know we struggle to do it. So this is just an example, but that same network that we put in, we're using for other technology in the store, including the video analytics I described. So on the personalization side, where do customers sit? So if you think about customers and the way retailers went to market, it was mass, and then it's evolved, right? We would segment customers and we would talk about, you know, shoppers on a budget or people that like to cook at home, and we had them all segmented. And then what you found was became more targeted, it became personalized, now it's personal. And the example I like to use is my wife and I are polar opposites in a store, right? She does not cook at all, thankfully. I'll tell you a quick story. So when we got married, she was cooking and I had these brand new set of pans and I go in the kitchen and I think she was making, if I remember, like potatoes. She loves mashed potatoes. So there's this fork in my metal pan, like, you know, it's like a horror movie. And I'm like, what are you doing? You know, no metal forks in my nice pans. But she's all a ready-to-eat person. I'm a baker. I cook from scratch. So if there's a new flour or something, I would want to know about it. My wife could care less. So the question is, how do we then start to talk to consumers at a personal level? One of the things that we also are, you know, spending a lot of time on are taste preferences. You like vanilla. We launch a new vanilla granola. Who might be the best person, and we know you like granola, who might be the best person to talk to about trying our new product? The person that likes vanilla and happens to like granola. When we work with suppliers, manufacturers, they want to know too, because they want to be efficient with their advertising and marketing spend. So all this data that we use to drive a better shopping experience also helps us make sure we have the right products in our stores. But it's become very much a personalized world. And our job is to continue to take all the data that we can and kind of package that up in a way that delivers value to all of you and your families. Now on the mobile front, this is certainly an easy way to engage with us with digital coupons. I think we're now up to roughly, I think, over 17 million downloads of our mobile app. And we, you know, that those literally started about 4 years ago. And what you see is, you know, that combination now at integration with ClickList, so that people can then, you know, quickly process their orders. We do a lot of things now to personalize even the website. So when you start your list or your recent purchases, right, it's your data. We're not going based on what somebody wants to try and sell you. We're going on what you want to buy. Right? So this is a customer-driven approach. So we put up the things that you care most about. I had a customer ask me the other day, which I thought was a great question. They said, well, I love the list feature and I love that you do this, but I bought something because I had a coupon, so you then started putting it on my list. Well, I only bought it with the coupon because it was a great deal, but normally I buy this other product. And I was like, that makes perfect sense, right? We were using the data, but we need to become smarter, right? We need to make sure that we're taking that, you know, consumer behavior and thought process and weave it into, you know, how we do better AI, how we do better machine learning, so that we're building smarter systems. And it was a great conversation. It was really enlightening for me because, well, I thought we had taken such a big step forward with the personalization of all of this. It was maybe a little bit too much for her. And she's like, no, you gotta back it off a notch and really better understand me. And I said, fair point. So this is all, you know, obviously mobile's where customers spend a lot of their time, and our job is to make, you know, the experience of engaging with Kroger and food as simple as possible. The other thing that's been really for us, and you know, we always talk about, you know, being the food authority, right? That's what we do for a living, is food. And we've curated a bunch of recipes, and the recipe now number is now, I think, over 15,000. But the thing that's really interesting about the recipes is it's becoming personalized. It's what do you like to eat? Are you a vegetarian? Are you vegan? If you are, then that's what we want to show you, right? We don't want to show a vegan, you know, a steak dinner that you can make. So this is where that personalization is becoming so powerful, is we can really start to, you know, help you sift through the mountains of data that are out there and find things that more quickly that matter most to you. This has been incredibly well received, and you know, to me it's an example of, once again, how can we take this data and get smarter? Customer insights, food trends. So if you think about, you know, what people say, whether it's eating healthier, they want to have a consistent meal prep and have dinner at home. The word that comes up often with our customers is they want to be a hero. They want to be a hero at home. How can we help them be a hero at home? Right? What can we do to allow dad or mom to be a hero with the kids? And they don't want the same thing every night. All right, well, how do we help them have a more diverse menu in their home? How can we, you know, help the person that says they want more high protein to actually get it? So there's a lot of food needs, and we talk about, once again, as a food authority, a lot of what we hear is, you know, the process is cumbersome, time-consuming, a chore. How many of you feel that way? How many of you love to cook? Oh, good. You're a little out of balance with most audiences, which is a good thing, I think. Certainly for us, but this is what happened. So what we built, back to our meal solutions, and you'll see this out in this part of the world in the not too distant future, but it's a tonight's dinner made easy. And the thing that we really tried to do was say 20 minutes or less. And we look at everything's measured and prepared. So vegetables are cut, proportioned appropriately. So literally you're an assembler. But the assembly creates a really elegant meal. Now, this meal on the right is steak chimichurri. And it is a very good meal. You can see the variety here that's in some of our stores in Cincinnati. And this is meant to be very much of a continual evolution of what we offer. What's the seasonal, you know, food that people want to eat in the fall versus the spring? How's it different in Colorado versus Cincinnati? So this really will be a program that's very much tailored to the market. But it's the other thing about this for us, as we think about it, we'll need to obviously deliver it to your home. So as you make those decisions close to dinner time, you say, hey, I want that. Well, we'll have to figure out a way to get this to your home. But the other thing about this is you can see it's very low packaging. So if you think about, you know, some of the other solutions in the market that they deliver to your home, you get an enormous amount of packaging. You get all kinds of, you know, styrofoam. You're going to get all kinds of freezer packs. So when we think about carbon footprint and sustainability, we think that what we've designed, it's a cardboard box, basically, very efficient. We think that this is going to really connect with customers in a big way. So we're really excited about this program. Now, on the food side, it's interesting. If I were to ask you what's local to you, how many of you would say your community? How many of you would say your state? It varies. And there's you know, across the country, Rocky Ford cantaloupe, certainly one that's pretty well known. I'd say that's probably state, but the people that live in Rocky Ford think it's theirs. We have tomatoes in Tennessee, Ripley, Tennessee. If you don't have local tomatoes from Ripley, Tennessee, you're not buying a tomato in Tennessee in that area. But so how do we effectively, you know, make sure that we're offering, you know, customers as much as possible from a local perspective? And you can see, you know, some of the signs. When you go into the produce department, you'll see a lot more from us about local. Now, it creates a little bit of complication in the supply chain, just a smidge. Just a smidge for those of us that do, you know, supply chain and technology work for a living, because it's a lot more variety. And we're buying literally at a local level. And how do we execute that? And you know, it's instead of working with a bunch of, you know, large, you know, farmers and suppliers, we're working with tens of thousands of small farmers. And it's doable. It's just a little more complicated, but we got to continue to automate that process so that it works well for all parties. All right, future opportunities. This is a picture of a digital shelf edge. It's in 17 stores in Cincinnati. This to me is not a question of if, it is purely a question of when. So I don't care whether it's hanging, you know, the classic tags above it, so you can see the $1.99, $1.49, and then you can see the apple juice sign. It's HD quality, you can play video on it. We can change prices in an entire store in about 5 minutes. And guess what? They're going to be 100% right. Now, a couple things. Obviously, you can do brand messaging on that shelf edge. One of the use cases that we're working on, which is, you know, it's not easy to do because it's somewhat data dependent, but let's say you go to the nutrition bar area and you happen to be gluten-free. Do you want to read every label of 100 different nutrition bars, or would you love for us to highlight for you on the shelf edge which ones are gluten-free? If you're shopping the store, we can highlight for you, you know, in the midst of all of the wine, which wine is on your list that you want to buy. There's just enormous application for this technology. We're super excited about it. For those that are kind of curious about how we do it, it's actually a rear projection system. So it's no different than, you know, a projection system in a conference room, except it's really small. The challenge was spreading that image across 4 feet and having it maintain the same resolution on the edges as it has in the middle. We've worked with half a dozen really, really smart companies around the world to build this. But it's pretty exciting, and I think it's the future of retail. And you're going to see, to me, a lot more of this kind of innovation because of the value that it creates and how we can help you with the shopping experience in the store. And by the way, it's equally good for associates. We talk about, how many of you have worked in a supermarket? A couple of you. If you do resets, which basically means you go in and move everything around, you do it once, twice a year. Well, this is basically, this system allows you to do resets by pictures. So I literally say, move this and two facings of Cheerios and move it over here and I want three facings of Cheerios. So it literally is doing it by pictures, which is compared to the old thing with pieces of paper, and it's just a dramatically different experience. So we're excited about this. This is here today. You know, broad national, you know, distribution of this technology is something in the works. By the way, we're doing much more in the way of commercialization. So if you think about Kroger as a technology company, we are, whether it's temperature tags or whether it's digital shelf edges. We have people around the world that are, you know, currently testing what we have to offer. And like I said, I think it is definitely where retail is headed. A couple other things as we kind of close up and certainly go to Q&A, extending customer insights into the ag industry. There's an enormous amount that we talk about, whether it's how we think about manufacturing. I talk a little bit about syncing demand and supply. How do we better provide demand signals to the ag world? What should we be growing? What are the hot food trends? How much of it do we think we're going to need? I mean, if we think about zero waste, zero hunger, which is something we talk about, you know, what can we do to collaborate to actually make that happen? And I think we have an enormous amount of insights and data and things that would be useful. The question is, how do we sync those things up? On the quality and safety mission, if you think about quality, and we're working with several different suppliers, what is the perfect time to pick that strawberry? Because it's going to have a huge impact on how long that strawberry is going to last. What's the humidity level that we should transport that strawberry at? And what's the temperature? Every piece of fruit has a slightly different, optimal, supply chain set of rules. How do we do that better? Right? How do we help make sure that those products are being picked at the perfect time? And how do we make sure that by the time they get from the field to the customer's mouth, that's the best experience possible? There are a lot of opportunity to work there. Obviously, carbon footprint, I talked a little bit about it before with meal kits and local farmers. We think that there's just enormous opportunity. A lot of the work that we've done, to use LED lighting, I think we're up to, I can't remember how many cars a year, the equivalent of energy we've taken off the road, but it's well over 1 million over the last couple of years. I mean, we just are continually investing in, how do we run our stores more efficiently? And there's enormous technology coming that'll help us do that. And then on the waste side, I mentioned the food digester that we're working with. We also feed, I think over the last 3 years, cumulatively, we've basically fed America with 1 billion meals, which is pretty awesome. It's probably the largest number of any company out there. So we feel really good about that. But even then, how can we do that more effectively? So for us, it's just a continued set of opportunities that we look at. How do we continue to leverage technology, drive innovation, to ultimately deliver a better value proposition and create that, emotional engagement with our customers? And with that, I want to just play you a quick video that talks a smidge more about sustainability, and then we'll do Q&A.
Your heart upon your sleeve. Life is just a dream. Ooh, lucky you. Lucky, lucky me. So meet me at the rainbow's end. We don't even have to pretend that we know what it is we're looking for. Life is just a dream. Ooh, lucky you. Lucky, lucky me. Life is just a dream. Lucky, lucky me.
That video was designed for the shareholders meeting earlier late last year. So thought that might be a good summary of a few of the highlights for how we thought about 2016. So with that, questions?
Well, let's first give a big round of applause for a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
And I do have some audience questions. There seems to be similar thoughts on folks' mind in the room, and so we can knock out a few with one question. The first one is, how would you say the pre-ordered groceries market is impacting business models?
Well, I think there's a couple things to think about. One is pre-ordering in some ways is nice because it gives us advanced demand signals. So instead of having this, not knowing each day exactly what's going to happen, we actually know a little bit in advance. So that's helpful for us. I think it also, you know, provides an opportunity for customers to get product in a different way. So they think about some people do view shopping as a chore, and it allows them to, you know, potentially consolidate trips where they may have gone once a month to go buy, you know, large bulk items somewhere, and then they buy, you know, produce and meat somewhere else. It actually allows, we see a consolidation of what maybe were before separate shopping trips.
Awesome. Kind of going off of that, what would you say in terms of that pre-order or customers not actually physically shopping in the stores? Do you consider that to be a continual trend into the future, or is it more of a niche market that will maintain a kind of smaller volume?
I think it's going to continue to grow, especially as we do more with home delivery. I think you're going to, and what we see is we continue to attract a slightly, sometimes new customers. So the click list, order online, pick up at store, there's no question it's new customers. We see, you know, increased spending from customers. So I think as you continue to make it more simple, you're going to see that continue to grow. One of the big opportunities in my mind is how do we drive the economics of the last mile? And we've obviously, there's a lot going on with autonomous vehicles, including in ag. I think in our world, that's going to be pretty important to solve in last mile. You know, so how can you drive the economics down so that you can literally be more like the meal kit, that you can say, hey, you know what, I'm on my way home from work. Kroger says, hey, we've got, you know, this new meal kit flavor, you know, salmon, Peruvian salmon. It's like, oh yeah, that sounds great. Well, today that's a order hours, if not a day in advance. But what if that's a 30-minute call? So you just 30 minutes and it's there. Think of it like, you know, you would have traditionally thought about pizza. You're thinking about that as a prepared meal or a meal kit. So I think this, what you're going to see is the continued optimization of the last mile delivery will be a big influencer. I think convenience and people's demand for time is going to continue to be a pressure that's going to drive volumes up. At the same time, we will be creating a more engaging experience. You know, I think the stores of today and of tomorrow are going to be radically different than the ones of, you know, 5-10 years ago in terms of experience. You know, sitting down with a friend and having a glass of wine and dinner will become a norm. It won't be an exception. And, you know, the one, there was a data point about 2 years ago where the money spent on restaurants exceeded the money spent on, you know, basically buying food to prepare for yourself. Those lines crossed a little over 2 years ago. So what that tells you is customers are, you know, they want convenience. They don't want to have to cook as much. I love it that most of you do, but that's trend-wise, that's not what's happening. That I think you're gonna have, you know, as we make it easier for customers, this order ahead, pick up, or have delivered to you will continue to grow, but it won't be infinite growth. I think it'll level off over the next couple years, and then you'll probably see a continued slow growth as we get the last mile figured out.
I think you would know pretty well how that's going to go.
it's an opinion.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. A couple questions here focus on Amazon, and we've, I think, talked a lot about Amazon throughout this summit. So what is your take on their position entering the grocery market, and do you feel like position-wise and competition-wise that Kroger can, what does that mean for Kroger and, you know, just dealing with that online grocery store?
As you can imagine, I've answered that question a few times over the last few months. In fact, I had a Wall Street Journal interview where I answered the question a couple months ago. It was specifically at the time around Amazon Go, and I don't know how many of you have seen the press around Amazon Go. Yeah, yes, no. Basically, in Seattle, Amazon created a store where there's no traditional checkout. You basically pick an item. You basically they identify you coming in the store, and as you grab items, they're basically adding that to your transaction, and then when you walk out of the store, they bill you automatically just like they would as an Amazon Prime customer. And I said, I'll believe it when I see it. And the reason I said that was it's a little bit like an autonomous vehicle, right? Can I drive a car down a freeway? Sure. Pretty simple. What about in traffic? And what about when a kid runs out in front of a car? Or what about when somebody runs a stoplight? It's the edge cases that are hard. And the technology that they put into that store is not scalable across a retail operator. I mean, you couldn't run stores that way. And their store is, twice the size of the stage, and it's got a fair bit of technology in it, let's just say. So look, it's a great concept. I think someday, will we eliminate checkout as we've historically known it? Yeah, probably. And I applaud them for continuing to push the envelope. I think what you've probably seen today is we push the envelope on a lot of technology as well, and we think it's pretty important, and we have a lot of applied technology successes that are in our stores today, and we have a lot more coming. So I think the other piece of the story is they're getting into physical stores. And I think a few years ago the world was like, oh, physical stores are dead, Amazon's gonna, it's all gonna be online. I think the people that were saying that are probably sitting there going, huh, maybe I guess physical stores matter. And I think they matter for food, and Amazon's been in the food business for well over 10 years, I think it's probably close to 15. Obviously, they haven't figured it out yet. So what I would say is food's a little bit harder. The supply chain's a little bit more delicate to manage, because you're talking about fresh food that's perishable, that has to be managed in the right way. So look, we love competition, and we love good competition, and I feel like the one thing about Kroger that we continue to focus on, back to having great locations, we have almost 2,800 stores that are in the best locations in the communities in which you live. And that's a huge asset for us. Now, we got to run those stores a smidge differently than we've run them in the past. We have to run them like distribution centers because people are ordering ahead. What is the balance on hand in the store? How do we ensure that we allocate inventory to the customer and that when we say when you order it, we have it, we actually have it and allocate it to you? So we're quickly transforming how we think about those 2,800 stores, but there's nobody better positioned to meet customers where they live and solve the last mile than us.
Excellent. I know you talked about it quite a bit in your presentation, but I think for those who are still in production agriculture in the room, they're just curious and interested in what are some of Kroger's attempts to increase their local suppliers, and so to continue to buy locally and support local farmers and growers.
Well, you saw a few pictures, and I would say we do it better in some markets than others. But what we literally do is it becomes in this part of the country, it's King Soopers and City Markets headquarters is in Denver. And it's that team in Denver working with the Fort Collins district and the stores that are here to identify and then source. And as you can imagine, if we're going to start sourcing product here in Fort Collins, we've got to reduce what we're buying elsewhere in the supply chain. So we have to continue to figure out how do we do that in a more elegant way. We do it in almost every store you go in, you're going to see local more and more. We just have to make it simple. Today, it's a little bit too hard for us to execute it and make it simple. So I think that the easier we make it, the better it's going to be for the farmers and the growers, because they're going to have predictability. They're going to know exactly what we need and when we need it. And that, once again, will all come through technology and how we think about managing the supply chain. Because if you think about it, you're gonna like as I said earlier, you're gonna have more farmer to store deliveries. Why take something all the way down to Denver if it's grown and picked here in Fort Collins. That's not helpful from a carbon footprint perspective, and it's not helpful from a food quality perspective. We gotta figure that out. And I would say that no one has really solved that one yet, but I think it's an enormous opportunity, and there's a lot of money going into figuring out how to better manage that.
Absolutely. Another fun topic that I think we've talked about and touched on quite a bit this summit revolves a lot about consumers and how do we keep track of where they're headed and what the consumer trends look like. You touched on it some, but what are some other ways that Kroger is gathering their information about where the consumer trends are going, and then how do you remain reactive to it as such a large organization?
We've been doing it for over 15 years. We've been kind of on this journey, and I would say that we get a little bit smarter every year. And as I mentioned earlier, I think one of the biggest pieces of the puzzle, think about in the old way we would think about a product would be, you know, what data do I need to get it in my distribution system and to order it? Well, today, that's not what I want to know, right? I want to know every ingredient that's in that product. I want to know where it was grown. Ideally, I want to know what, you know, transport mechanism it took and what logistics center it went through. So I have this insatiable need to get more data. Why? Because people do have food allergies. People do have, you know, food preferences that they care about. And to me, it's a big industry opportunity, is how do we improve the quality of the data in the food world so that companies like Kroger and frankly others can take advantage of it to do this optimization. Right, do I know a lot about you and your families and what you buy, and do I give you offers that are relevant for you and all that? Absolutely, and we do that better than anybody else. But how much more could I do for you if I had better data? I knew more about what you felt in social media. And I would say it's an industry issue. We've been actively working to improve particularly product level data for years. And it's a passion for me and for our company, because we know how many doors it unlocks from a customer perspective.
Excellent. One other question that comes to mind, we talked about becoming a more sustainable organization, both in energy use and the consumption, trying to limit food waste. And you mentioned the biofuel energy generator for the manufacturing. Do you feel like that is in a place where that can be, it's economically viable to continue to expand in that, or has that technology not quite caught up to the demand?
Well, as probably most of you know, and I'm not an expert in this area, but there are an enormous number of, you know, tax credits and, you know, things that you get when you push new technology like that. When you're thinking about, you know, how does that translate into like the future? I think people are going to continue to make that technology better. They're going to continue to make it cost effective. You know, when we built the first digital shelf edge, it was a little bit expensive. But it gets cheaper every year because we continue to value engineer it and say, how do we make it more cost effective? And I believe that, you know, smart people are going to continue to make, you know, solar more cost effective. And we have a fair bit of solar in our company, and we have some LEED certified stores. And, you know, so we're continuing to work down that path. But I think we're going to have to continue to rely on innovators out there to continue to think about, you know, better, faster, cheaper ways of bringing this technology to market in a way that, you know, it's not a government subsidy that makes it successful. It's the technology itself that's ready for prime time. And we're not there yet with most of these technologies. We're just not. Do I think we'll get there? Yeah, I think we will.
Definitely a valuable perspective. Well, I'm out of questions up here, but I believe we have some more from the floor.
Is artificially synthesized meat a possibility? I've eaten some of it. It tasted okay, but it was a little weird. I don't know. You know, it's a great question. I think I've seen it done. I've eaten it, and it tasted pretty good. and it was a vegetable-based, protein. Looked like a steak, cooked like a steak. Didn't quite taste like it. Texture was a little bit different. I think it's viable, and like anything, it consumers get to certain points where they're willing to take that next step. And some folks, are more ready to take that step than others. But based on what I saw personally, I can only speak for this one company that I was with, I think it's certainly viable.
Do you think Kroger will implement it in their stores one day if it becomes viable?
I think what the best way to think about it is we put in our stores what our customers want us to put in our stores. So when the customers say we want it in our stores and there's demand to support it, I mean, if you look at the natural and organic meats today, and whether it's buffalo or bison or alternative meats, I mean, the meat case today looks nothing like it did 10 years ago. And that's because customers, have asked for it, and they've pushed it. So I think as the innovators innovate and come up with new things, and we fully intend to be a leader. And that's one of the things that we pride ourselves on, is being first to market with things that matter to customers. And I know one of the recent launches was on these, on a halo top kind of protein-based low calorie desserts. They call it ice cream, but that wouldn't be fair to the people that make real ice cream. But if you've tried it, it's a pretty good product. And we were one of the first to have it at scale, and we have it in I think almost every one of our stores now, and customers really like it. So I think for us, it's you can absolutely work with suppliers and innovators to bring new ideas to market. Customers are the ultimate voters.
In rural Colorado, Loaf and Jug is often the only food store. Have you explored opportunities to get full grocery offerings or click list in these locations?
Great question. There's two issues. One is the Loaf and Jug stores are a bit on the tiny side for adding a lot of a food experience. The other thing is, could they become a future clickless pickup location? The answer is absolutely, they could become a future pickup location. The other thing I'll share with you is that we do have a new store format. We have two of them in Columbus, Ohio, and it's called Fresh Eats Market. And Fresh Eats Market is roughly 14,000 square feet. It has a pharmacy. It has a Fresh Eats made-to-order small kind of quick-service restaurant. It has a Starbucks in it. It has a limited grocery shopping experience. All I can tell you is the people in those local communities love it. And the question is, and we will eventually have that as a pickup location for ClickList. So the question is, can we get the economics right? And if we can, and the supply chain gets a little bit tricky because it becomes a little bit more piece pick than case pick, not to get too much into the weeds, but if we're picking and delivering cases to stores through a warehouse, you get a lot of efficiencies of scale. If I have to start picking item by item, which we do some of for our stores, but if that becomes kind of the way that a smaller store has to be serviced, we got to make the supply chain more cost effective. Is it doable? Absolutely. But to me, That future of small store is exciting, and we like the two experiments we're running, and we plan to try a few more.
Yesterday with the students, Tom Vilsack talked a lot about food deserts, both in cities and rural areas. What has Kroger done to fill those across the country?
I think the Fresh Eats Market that I just described is a potential solution. We're also working on a format called Ruler, which is a value format. We're doing it kind of through Indiana, Illinois, which we think we can cost-effectively, provide a grocery solution in, other markets. We just announced recently that we're opening up a new Kroger store in downtown Cincinnati. And to me, that's pretty exciting because it's an opportunity for us to kind of bridges a couple different parts of downtown Cincinnati, but we're pretty excited about making that work. And you know, the big challenge that you run into is in the food deserts is to make them economically viable. I mean, look, if you put a store in there, you know, can you make it work? And it's hard. It's just flat out hard. But I do think things like ClickList, where we could potentially allow customers to order online and take a truck, you know, and have it be there for X number of hours, and customers can come get their orders from a central place in a particular neighborhood. I think you're going to see different models emerge that maybe don't make the big physical investment, but leverage technology, digital, and bring food to customers in a different way. And I think there are ways that can be economically done that works for the retailers as well as the customers.
Are consumers comfortable with someone else selecting their produce with online ordering? And how do you personalize this?
Great question. The answer is, it depends. You'd be amazed at how many customers order online but still come in the store to pick produce. Now, we train our associates to pick produce. We're actually giving more granularity to customers now to tell us, do you want green bananas, you know, kind of green-yellow or yellow? So that we can help the people picking make sure that they get it right. For me, one of my personal passions is avocados. And you know, a ripe avocado, if you eat avocados a lot, is pretty easy to figure out. But if you're not an avocado eater, and you're picking avocados, that one can be a little bit tricky. So for us, you have to remember, we're teaching people to pick produce and meat and seafood the way you would do it. And that's hard. Now, one of the other things we're doing is kind of, and we do this really well at Harris Teeter, but it's a personal relationship, right? The person that picks your order is the person that we want to pick your order every time. And what you find is that they develop a relationship. And through that relationship comes trust. And we allow for feedback. So that loop of feedback then makes it more trusting. And I can, you know, if I'm picking your order, then you could say, hey, well, you know, you didn't get this quite right. Next time, you know, you pick, you know, avocados for me, I'd like them more like this. Okay, great, you just taught me, you know, something that was personal to you. So I think it's a combination of us continuing to figure out ways to train people and allow customers to, you know, be more specific about what they want. But the more we can create that personal feedback loop with customers, I think it'll make it easier for us to consistently execute.
I think we have about time for one more question. Do you have one there? Or?
I didn't, but I can ask
one. Well, I think I've got one too. You talking about how do you... you know, have pickers that have a personal understanding of the customer. It kind of touches on agricultural literacy a little bit in my mind, and that's something that was talked around our table last night at we had a round table dinner. Do you think are there current partnerships and possibilities with partnering with different agricultural organizations that promote the education of where food comes from?
Absolutely. We're doing a really cool experiment with augmented reality in the seafood department, where you can basically go up with your phone or a tablet and actually scan the barcode, and then we'll tell you where that fish came from. We'll tell you potentially who caught the fish if we have that data. So you create this much richer set of data that allows, by the way, that's good for the customer that wants it, but think about how powerful that is for the associate to be that much more educated. Right, so if we can help the associate answer that question in the right way, and we can help them feel knowledgeable and experienced, right, the better we do that, the better that they're going to be able to take care of the customer. And so whether the customer does it for themselves or we help the associate do it, I think the answer is absolutely that's where we're headed.
Excellent. Well, I think we're rounding up, but one more round of applause for Mr. Hjelm.